In May, William Ruto, Kenya's president, was being feted by the White House at a glittering gala dinner hosted by Joe Biden in the first state visit by an African leader to the US in 16 years. By July, Washington's favorite dinner guest was facing a popular revolt at home. He fired his cabinet and gestation tax rising legislation that had led to national protests, culminated in the storming of parliament and taking off the mask. Ruto is not the first leader whose polished international image fails to reflect his sinking domestic reputation. But he is a stark example of the difficulty reconciling global obligation, which Kenya's case includes servicing a ruinously high debt, with domestic political realities. Ruto swept the power in 2022 on a populist swell after appealing to the nation's hustlers, those scrubbing to living through their wits and hard work. In a nation of 56 million with only 3 million formal jobs to go around, reaching out to the masses in the informal economy, the street hawkers, shoe shiners, day laborers, subsistence farmers, worker, market women, Uber drivers, and so on, was electoral dynamite. Ruto ran without endorsement of the incumbent Uhuru Kenyatta, but he used his mass appeal to open doors of state house, and in many ways, his electoral revolution was commendable. He is not a saint, to be sure. He made a fortune alongside politics and survived the indictment by the International Criminal Court for alleged orchestration of political violence in the year 2007. But his appeal to the unrepresented underclass transcended to ethnic rivalries that have been tirelessly exploited by Kenyan political class. By relying on an increasingly urban and well-informed electorate, Ruto tapped into modern idea, that of social contract between voters and the government, promising to deliver services and opportunity. But having stirred up popular sentiment, Ruto has unleashed a force he can no longer control. Protests have been leaderless, hydro-headed, with no kingpin to pay off or ethnic rivalries to foment. In a normal time, he might have made things work, but he inherited a sinking fiscal situation. Before you bring out your villain, recall your deputy president and previous administration. The Kenyatta government borrowed and spent misled huge amounts of money, much of which was wasted extravagant projects, including 4 billion plus and half completed Chinese built single gauge railway that have increased Kenya's debt without yielding economic return. According to Ken Opalo, an associate professor at Washington's Georgetown University, Kenyatta added $51 billion to the $22 billion debt pile he started with. Servicing those obligations swallows an unsustainable 38% of revenue. In the words of one Ruto's advisors, Kenyatta's government swept the national credit card. Ruto has avoided a default through some clever financial footworks, but he has had to punish his own hustler support base with the IMF endorsement program to increase tax revenue to eventually reach 25% of GDP from current level of 15%. That is not easy to do when quality of services has been declining. There can be no taxation without electrification. nor it is palatable that taxpayers on the formal sector are so few. Extracting tax from the masses in the formal sector is so painful. Squeezing an extra 2.3 billion out of the population with an average income of $2,000 is hard enough when the motive is paying off international borrowers and creditors. It has proved impossible. One placard during recent protests, which so many as 50 people were shot dead, read, "We ain't IMF bitches." Ruto's tax rising efforts have ignited social movement that should be a warning to the fiscality constrained governments. Nigeria, take note. Unfortunately for Ruto, the fight is more complex than simply between poor Kenyans and ruthless international debt collectors. Most protesters blame politicians for running up debts and siphoning off some of the proceeds. Kenya's elite enjoy fishing their wealth. Look at the lifestyle they are constantly parading on social media, says Patrick Gathara, a political cartoonist, adding that politicians cannot resist flaunting first-class travel, designer clothes, and private helicopters on TikTok. For a populist, Ruto, reading of the popular mood has been inept, having failed to subdue demonstration through the violence and intimidation. He has been forced to capitulate. Now he is venting his wrath on political class, of which is part of. Henceforth, he has promised it will steal less peace and perform better. If Ruto manages to deliver the pledge, he may salvage his reputation both at home and abroad. So the Kenyans have said they're going to occupy Uhuru Park tomorrow and they will stay there until Ruto goes home. So let us see how things unfold. And if you are, in case you are new to this channel, kindly subscribe and hit the notification bell so that anytime we produce a video, you will be notified. So thank you guys, and let's see you in the next video.